Good evening and welcome back to tonight's Selectman's Debate in Billerica. My name is Tom Zupa. I'm managing editor at The Sun. I'll be the moderator for this session. Earlier we had candidates for school committee who debated. Two of the three candidates were here this evening. If you missed any part of that debate or wish to watch it again, it'll be available on Lowell Sun's YouTube page later this evening. Tonight we have four candidates for the Board of Selectmen. There's 2 3-year seats in the April 2nd town election. Four candidates here this evening are, from left, Selectman George Similaris, Finance Committee member Ed Giroux, Selectman Michael Rosa, and School Committee member Kim Conley. Candidates, thank you for being here this evening. All four candidates have agreed to the ground rules in advance, and they are as follows. There will be no opening statement. They will take questions from me that have been developed both by Sun editors and readers at large. All questions have been screened and are fair and equally applicable to all candidates. There will be no time limit on answers, but I've asked the candidates to please be succinct and stay on topic and not to filibuster. I've also asked them to keep on topic and refrain from personal attacks. So we'll move on from there. Finally, they will have a 2-minute closing statement and we'll wrap up probably about 9 p.m. So once again, candidates, thank you for being here this evening. And we're going to dive right into the questions. So we'll ask you to start with you first. Microphone, please. It's on.
Hello? Can you hear me? Yes.
Okay. I'm going to ask everybody to speak directly into the microphone because we did have an issue. Some people in the back couldn't hear earlier, so if you could speak clearly into the microphone, that would be great. Okay, Mr. Similaris, you go first. The tenor of this race has been heated at times, especially on social media. Without referring to any of your opponents, why is being a selectman important to you?
Well, first of all, the Board of Selectmen and the executive branch of the town government, he's supposed to set policies, and town meeting is supposed to look at what selectmen say and take it seriously when they make their votes. So why is it important to be a selectman? First of all, I have the honor of being a selectman. I have the trust of the people that elected me, and for the people that didn't elect me, I still want to work for them and everybody to make our town a better town. And that's what I have done, and that's what I'll continue to do if I'm reelected. I have a lot of energy, and I try to look upon our town. I'm very proud to be living in Billerica, and I try to improve our town by any utilization of any ways I can, mainly through our residents and thinking and trying to talk about issues that need to be improved. Thank you.
Mr. Giroux.
Thank you. So I think it's important to be a selectman simply because this town has given me so much and it's given my family so much. It's time for me to give back. I've served the town in town meeting, served on the finance committee for several years, and various other committees that I'm sure we'll talk about later tonight. But I think it's important simply to give back to the community and keep the progress moving forward. I think that all too often this board has been, as Tom mentioned, in the headlines for the wrong reasons. And I want to make the town better. You all, at the end of the school committee meeting, you talk about the reputation of the town. I want to work to improve that. There's a negative reputation out there from folks that I work with that live in other towns that say, what is going on in your town? And I want to end that. I want to put Billerica on the headlines for the positive reasons. Because this town is a good town, it's a great town. I enjoy living here, and it's time to give back. Thank you.
Mr. Rosen.
Thank you. First and foremost, why I want to be a selectman and why I've always wanted to be a selectman is to help people. I've been on the board for a while, and one of my paramount things that I think I'm known for in this town is if somebody has a problem, whether it be a group or an individual, if they come to me, I will give 110% to try to help them. You know, we set policy on the board, we give liquor licenses, we do all kinds of licensing, but the gratifying part of being on the board of selectmen is when somebody comes to you with a problem, and you're able to help them fix that problem. It could be as simple as a pothole, or more complex, like they have a frozen water line at their house and they don't have water. I've always strived to try to help everyone that's come to me, not only individuals, but groups in town. And I'm excited about what's going on. I mean, the comments were made about negative press in the paper, but you know, if you watch the last selectmen's meeting, we did our goals and objectives, and we talked about all the positive stuff that's going on in Billerica. Billerica is a great place to live, work, and raise a family. And you looked at their goals and objectives we talked about at the selectmen's meetings. We've got a boat launch coming. We're working on a bike path. We've got economic development happening. For the first time in the history of Billerica, we've lowered the property taxes commercially and residentially. And in that year, we lowered those commercial and residential properties. We're scheduling over $20 million worth of infrastructure work in town. We're maintaining our buildings. Look at the town hall, the work that's being done there. Our library, our senior center. There's so much exciting, positive stuff going on. Billerica is a great place. I'm a lifelong Billerica resident. I've gone through the Billerica schools. I work in Billerica. I live in Billerica. And I'm excited to be back, be on the Board of Selectmen, and I want to be reelected so I can continue the positive movement that we're moving forward. Thank you. Mrs. Conway.
Thank you. So your question was, why is being selected important to me?
Why is it important to you?
Right,
personally?
Exactly. So I was born and raised in Billerica, attended Billerica schools, and like most of us, I love this town. I truly love Billerica. I think that my background is at a point in time where I can help this Board of Selectmen. I have always been and will continue to focus on improving Billerica. It's time that this board needs a fresh new perspective, and I can be that fresh new perspective. So why is it important to me? It's important to me because I want to move Billerica forward. I will not be an obstructionist. I will welcome new ideas and new ways of doing things. I will work with professionals. I will listen to advice from trained professionals, and I will act on their inputs. Why is it important to me? Because I think I can make a difference in Billerica, and I think I can make Billerica an even better community than it is today.
Okay, thank you, candidates. I think Mr. Giroux will take the next question. I want to dovetail to something you said earlier. This is a question we received from a reader. Actually, received a lot of questions from readers that we won't get to all of them tonight. But residents often speak about the lack of variety in restaurants and retail shopping in town. We hear about great work being done toward attracting new businesses, yet we seem to be struggling in a lot of other areas. Why does Billerica have a reputation that is, which they're unable to attract new businesses to town?
I don't know why we have the reputation that we do. Quite frankly, I think, as the other candidates have said and I said earlier, I think this is a great place to live and to work. I think there's been some issues in terms of zoning, in terms of where certain businesses can be and where they can't be. For whatever reason, we're having trouble attracting or filling some commercial retail space along Boston Road. Former town manager actually got in trouble for talking about the work and its lack of curb appeal. And unfortunately, there's some truth to that. So I think to attract new businesses, I'm looking forward actually to working with Rob Anderson as the economic development coordinator. And you mentioned he's brought in some businesses in town. He's done a great job in that regard. I'm looking forward to see what he does for us in terms of the retail commercial sector up and down Boston Road. I'm looking forward to that, and I hope that he's got some good things in store for us. I'm sure he does. And the reason why we have the negative reputation, I think a lot of it has to do with the economics. Quite frankly, there was some available space in Burlington, there's some available space here. And along 128, the businesses are likely to get more customers because there's simply more people to attract. But once those fill up, I think people will start to realize through Rob Anderson and his efforts that Billerica is a great place to be, right on the intersection of 3 and 495. And will attract those businesses also, those retail and restaurant commercial businesses.
Okay, Mr. Rosa.
Thank you. Well, I certainly recognize the importance of economic development. When our former economic development coordinator resigned, it was a part-time position. It was during my tenure as chairman, 2014 into 2015. And when the town manager was going to hire a part-time economic development coordinator to replace that person, I, along with the board, said, no, we need to hire a full-time economic development coordinator to help fill our vacant commercial and industrial space and put Billerica on the map. But not just to let people know where Billerica is, but to help shepherd those companies into Billerica, help them with the permitting. So we have a good reputation that not only are we bringing businesses into Billerica, but it's a smooth transition into Billerica. And that word will spread throughout the community. Now, your specific question was relative to retail dining. And I don't think it's so much that we have a negative reputation. What you have to look at is when restaurants come to Billerica, come to any community, what they look at is how many people are in that community during the weekday and how many people are in that community on the weekends. And Billerica, because of all of our commercial industrial space, has thousands of extra people during the week. But on the weekends, we don't retain those people. So we need to do things to make people come into the weekends so that we have higher population over the weekends that will go to those restaurants. And we're doing a lot to do that. Some of those things that we're doing is creating a bike path that'll bring people into Billerica. The boat launch. We'll have one of the only boat launches on the Concord River, and that'll bring people into Billerica. We're looking for ways to draw people in on weekends, which will make us that much more desirable to those restaurants that want to come to places where there's a high amount of people on weekends where they put the most amount of their business. Mrs. Conway.
Thank you. So the question regarding economic development, or why is there a negative opinion of why can't we attract businesses to Billerica, is truthfully, the town has done a good job bringing in Rob Anderson. I think we're all in agreement on that. But we have not enabled him to be successful. Billerica, I've talked to business people that do business here. Billerica is a very, very difficult place to get permit approval. We have some of the most strenuous stormwater approval. It's just very difficult to get things through. It takes months, if not years. And this, when you look to relocate a business in town, you do it based on what you hear from your real estate agents. And if what you hear from your real estate agents are that it's very difficult to get through the planning process, it's very difficult to get approval, then you're going to be hesitant to relocate here. And I think that's part of our issue. I think it can easily be addressed. And you know, honestly, I think it could be addressed by having routine department head meetings specifically focused on economic development and how we improve the permit process. So I think we have a long way to go, and we've started in a great direction, but there's a long way to go.
Mr. Harris, and then Mr. Rose, you wanted to add something?
Yes.
Well, so we were talking about the restaurants, as you go back to the
restaurants and retail.
And retail in general. Of course, I've had a lot of people say to me, you know, the mall at Kmart, and why can't we bring in some better stores and better restaurants? And, well, first thing I would have to say is the tax rate in Billerica is rather high for business and commercial. It's $33 and change per 1,000. So an example would be that the Carriage House across from Pro Fitness, the Red Barn there, was built in the 1880s. It's a beautiful old building, and I know the people there for a long time. They sold a piece of their land to put a house in it to, because the taxes were high. They couldn't keep their, it's $21,000, I believe, a year of tax. It's less than an acre of a land, and only for the Red Barn. Burlington has a cheaper tax rate for business and commercial, and there's a lot of action going on in there. So if you were a restaurant, you know, where would you rather set up a restaurant, make an investment into it? However, I think that the market should prevail, and you know, we can afford to have restaurants. We could support restaurants here. So you know, I'm happy. I voted also to bring on the economic development director this year, and you know, it's not just going to be him. I think it's going to be people that want to make an investment in Billerica. I think that a good restaurant could suffice here, and I think some big stores could suffice. So you know, the tax rate's high, number one, and we're working now for restaurants to cut down on the requirement for parking. You have to have so much parking to for a restaurant, and it's a little larger than what we think it should be. So we're working on that right now. But one example that I would say comes to my mind is where Marshall's Auto Sales are on the beautiful Concord River, right on the corner there. And you know, I think that restaurants came and went out of that place. And I really like Marshall's Auto, and I'm glad that they're doing well. But I would much prefer to see Boston Road have a nice restaurant in that location rather than a lot of cars sitting in that parking lot along our beautiful river. So, you know, I think it's a high tax rate, and I think that eventually that some nice restaurants will come. We have Garrison's. Augustus is busy all the time, and, you know, we'll see what happens. Thank you.
Okay, now, Mr. Rose, you wanted to add something?
Yes. You know, Rob Anderson's been here for less than a year. There's no question where we've got a long ways to go, but we've made significant improvements in a short amount of time. Mrs. Conway talked about there needs to be planning meetings. Those are already happening. Mr. Anderson is meeting with our planning director to help with the flow of people going through the process. Lowell Hospital has just leased 9,200 square feet in Billerica. EMD Serono has just gone through the planning board process to build 14,600 square feet of new office space. Mr. Anderson has sent out mailers to over 750 companies and that may want to locate in Billerica. So we are being very proactive in filling our commercial industrial space. And in 2014, we did actually lower the commercial and residential tax rates.
Okay, Mrs. Conway, your mission, I'll give you a chance to respond if you wish.
Yes.
And then I'd like to move on if we can.
So the reality is, and it is a reality, we have a very bad reputation. It has to go through too many boards, it takes too long, and it takes so long. The key deliverable for a company, as I can speak firsthand, is time to market. And if it takes so long to get approval that you can't achieve your time to market, and people aren't interested in relocating here. And that's a fact, and I can say that firsthand. So we do not have department head meetings focused on planning and to relocate companies here. I think that's a place to start. And we really, really, I can't stress enough, we must streamline the process. It's just too onerous for people, for homeowners and for businesses.
Okay, thank you. We're gonna move on to the next question. This one, I'll start with you, Mr. Rosa. We've heard the argument made for several boards in the past few months that pedestrian accidents are a sign that an area may not be safe. Given the recent accident in the town center in which two teenagers were injured, is the town center safe?
Well, first of all, I'm going to limit my comments because, as we said at the selectmen's meeting Monday night, that situation is still under investigation through the police department, and they haven't reported back to us. Now, obviously, if there's something that we can do to make it safer, we will. But keep in mind, the town just went through over $300,000 in safety improvements in the center. Those safety improvements include the crossing lights, the brick crosswalks, which give a textured feel, they are lined with granite. The accident that happened in the center is very unfortunate. We always have an eye on safety. The Board of Selectmen has directed the town manager to do thermoplastic striping for all the crosswalks throughout the town. That is a brighter, higher crosswalk. It's more visible to drivers. We're doing that throughout the entire town starting this year so that the crosswalks will be more visible throughout the town. We also set a policy of standardization of crosswalks. Sometimes you look in town and there could be two parallel lines. Sometimes there are two parallel lines with crosshatch lines as well. We've standardized that so everyone's looking for the same thing. We're committed to pedestrian safety in the town, and we've shown that through not only what we've done in the center, but what we've done in Mokosi Beach. We put a flashing crossing light there. If you remember, about 4 years back, there was a young child hit. We put the flashers there. We also, where the child's play area is at Mokosi Beach, we put a double fence. So after you've crossed the Middlesex Turnpike and you're headed over to that child's play area and you're walking on the sidewalk, should your child pull out of your hand, he can't go into the Middlesex Turnpike. You're in that corralled area, if you will, all the way up into the child's play area. So we've constantly got an eye on safety. We've made safety improvements. We're going to continue to make safety improvements. And we'll do whatever we need to make the town as safe as possible.
Mrs. Conway.
Let me start by saying the pedestrian accident in the center is terrible. It was a terrible thing that happened. And it's extremely unfortunate because it could have been avoided. So your question was, is the town center safe? No, it's not. Not for pedestrians. And I will state very strongly that that absolutely could have been avoided. In spring 2014 through fall 2014, the town hired traffic consultants to evaluate the center. The consultants, along with the town engineer, recommended to the Board of Selectmen that we put a bump out as we go along from Cummings taking a left down Boston Road. The bump out, it would have left you with the third travel lane, would not have been allowed to travel. That's a hard lane to see when you're crossing. It's exactly where the accident happened. So no, our center is not safe. It was avoidable, but once again, our current Board of Selectmen ignored the inputs of experts, trained professionals that came before them and made recommendations, and they were flat out refused to listen to them. So it absolutely is not safe.
Okay, Mr. Similaris.
Thank you. I hate to say it, but I've been in the center probably, I won't say I hate to say it, I actually enjoy the center, but I've been in the center as much as anybody, and I think I'm pretty much an expert on the center as much as anyone. But the point is I disagree wholeheartedly with Mrs. Conway that this accident could be avoided. I don't know the details of the accident, but it was driver, you know, incurred by driver that I believe that it was not paying attention. And you know, how do you avoid an accident where it's driver error? So, but anyway, I don't know the details of this, but I know that the woman took off. I know that she hit the kids. And I know that I think one thing that could be improved in the center truck is that the crosswalk light that was installed on the sides, when we, I put this on the agenda, I know after I became a member of the Board of Selectmen, or I know I was going to put it on the agenda, or I may have put it on the agenda, I know we immediately wanted to talk about making this center safety, safer after the 2012 vote, where we decided overwhelmingly not to change the structure of the center. However, when we did get this project going, all of a sudden the manager asked the engineers to conduct a study, and Mr. Conway, the traffic safety officer, and the engineers came before the Board of Selectmen, and they all of a sudden came up with this idea to have bump outs. And these bump outs were going to occur in five different locations, actually six. We did implement one of them. And these bump outs were going to go where the crosswalk lights are now. If you look at the center where traffic crosswalk lights have been installed, they were going to pop out into the road, I believe, over 3 feet in all areas. So that would have been a 3 foot jump out into the road on one side, on the other side, then on the other side going north, they would have had a 3 foot bump out there. They were also going to have a bump out that went when you can take a left in front of O'Connor's. This would have strangled traffic. It would have been very hard to plow, and it would have been terrible. So I disagree with these so-called experts on that, number one. The other thing is, I asked for an overhead light, as we have on River Street. The overhead light at River Street, where the elderly housing is, there's a light that's always green. Somebody comes up to that light, they hit a button, it turns yellow, and it goes red. The green crosswalk light over the crosswalk would illustrate there's something there, that something's going to happen. And if that was implemented, the engineers, experts, didn't want that light. So I believe that this case, the center is not safe. Now, those crosswalk lights are a false sense of security, and people hit them and they don't look. And they're not, it's not safe. But once we put a light over the crosswalk, I think it would be a lot better. Another problem is the speed. We need a cop sometimes to be on foot walking around the center. I mean, I'm an expert. I see how fast people come in there, and I don't want to turn us into a speed trap city, but we need to have more police presence on foot sometimes in the center. If other companies can pay to have someone let traffic out all along industrial complexes, why can't we have a cop in the center?
Okay, Mr. Lesh, we're going to move on now. Mr. Giroux.
Thank you. So I just want to double back real quick to the tax rate. Mr. Seligman Samalaris mentioned that the commercial tax rate is too high. Through discussions I've had over the years with various town officials, tax rate is actually one of the lowest on the list for priorities when they come to move to a town. So I just want to establish that. As far as the question at hand, the traffic safety in the town center, I agree that the town center is not safe currently. I also agree, I didn't realize actually, that when you're elected to the Board of Selectmen, you become a traffic engineer. I don't plan on becoming a traffic engineer. I plan on listening to the experts who have been trained and schooled in this discipline. And I disagree that the traffic engineers were wrong. There was an opportunity for bump out. There was also an opportunity for crosshatches, which again would have eliminated that third lane. I'm not going to go out to say that those crosshatches or the bump out would have prevented the accident. I don't know that for a fact. I'm not going to go out and say that. But the crosswalks themselves, they do look nice. The brick crosswalks do look very, very nice, actually. But quite frankly, it's like putting shoe polish on a sneaker. It just isn't enough to facilitate pedestrian safety in the center. Thank you.
Mr. Rosa, Mrs. Conway mentioned actions of the Board of Selectmen, which you remember. I'd like to give you 1 minute, if you can, to respond to that, if you wish.
Yeah, thank you. Relative to that bump out, this accident happened 350 feet away from where it was. To say this bump out would have stopped this accident, nobody can say. It was an accident. But here's the thing you have to realize. You want to talk about the experts? Kelly Conway, the town engineer, in her analysis to the Board of Selectmen, said, with that bump out, tractor-trailer trucks would not be able to make that corner without driving over the very bump out where pedestrians would think that they were safe. And I said at the Selectmen's meeting then, we would be creating the exact same scenario that we have on the other side of Cummings Street, which is where tractor-trailer trucks literally drive up over the sidewalk because they cannot traverse around that corner. In fact, Selectman Burns had video of a tractor-trailer truck trying to go around that corner, driving over the barrels that we had because we did a mock-up of that bump out. So had there been somebody standing on that bump out when that tractor-trailer came by, he would have driven over them as he did drive over the barrels. So to say that that bump out would have stopped this, nobody knows what could have put stop an accident, but this wouldn't have done it. This would have created more of an issue for pedestrians, just like we have on the opposite corner on Cummings Street.
Mrs. Conway, would you like to add something?
Yes, please. So let me just clarify, Mr. Rosa, Kelly Conway is no relation, she's a town engineer, no relation to me. But just for clarification, it's not where the bump out was, and Mr. Rosen knows this, it's where the hash marks were to be, and there wouldn't be a travel lane there. And I would urge everybody to go back and watch the selectmen's meeting from June 6th, I think, where the traffic engineer, Kelly Conway, spoke, and she absolutely did not say a tractor trailer could make it around that corner. That's false. Mr. Burns was up there for a day and a half filming to make that appear that you couldn't make the corner. Miss Conway absolutely, positively was in favor of the bump out. And once again, it's the case where our selectmen become experts. We pay, why do we bother paying for a traffic consultant if we have experts that don't listen? So it's really, frankly, it's a shame that as Mr. Giroux said, it's truly a shame that we have people that think they're experts who don't listen to people who went to college for this, that have attended seminars, that know what they're doing. I think that these people go to the cities and the other towns, and the other towns and cities, frankly, they listen to them, listen to the recommendations. I never said that the accident wouldn't happen. I said, was it potentially avoidable?
Okay, what I'd like to do is, I'd like to just give everybody one more quick shot at this, and then maybe move on. Mr. Similash, would you like to add something?
Yes, I would.
And we can keep to 1 minute.
I just want to say, first of all, I care about the safety of our residents. The brick that was over through the center, I think it would have looked just as well green. And I think it might have been safer to agree. But the point is that the people that wanted to do the center over haven't given up on it. And, you know, I think we have one of the most beautiful centers in New England. And I think it's never going to be safe when you have people traveling, all the people that we have come through our town that work here. The center was here when we had a small town. And I hope that our center will be preserved without people parking up on it. I hope our center will stay like it is long after I'm gone, with some improvements. We can always improve it. But these bump outs would have strangled traffic, so the people that wanted to change it can say, hey, look, this center is not working. We got to change it. Let's throw $25 million or whatever it'll cost now and bulldoze the center over. And I hope we don't ever do it. Thank you.
Okay, Mr. Giroux.
I don't want to bulldoze the center. Just want to put that out there. It's not going to happen. The center project, actually, the original project from 4 years ago, has nothing to do with what we're talking about. This is simply some hash marks or bump out that we would have made the traffic flow a little bit better. And I I'm not going to say that it would have prevented the hit-and-run accident, but I think it would have improved the safety overall. Thank you.
Yeah, Mr. Rose, I'll give you 30 seconds if you can just go and then move on to something else.
Very quickly, thank you. The fact that Mrs. Conway, at the Board of Selectmen's meeting, said, and she had a study, and the engineers that we hired said this, a tractor-trailer truck in the far left-hand lane could not traverse that corner with the bump out there. That is a fact. It's on the record of the selectmen's meeting. If you watch the meeting, you will see. They could not traverse that corner if they were in the far left-hand lane. That's what the video Selectman Burns took proves. That's what our engineering proved, and that's what the consultants said.
Okay, we're going to move on from bump outs now, and let's move on to another development question. Mixed-use districts, Mrs. Conway, this is for you. Mixed-use districts have failed twice at town meeting. Is the third time going to be the charm? Should it be brought forward again?
I absolutely believe we should bring it forward again. I think there, it's a time and a place, and I think Billerica is ready for mixed-use. I think we weren't a couple of years ago. I think it's been 3 or 4 times that it's come before town meeting. And honestly, I don't think it was ready. Imagine, if you will, that we had a center that's similar to Woburn, where on the bottom maybe you have You have nice little shops. We just talked about bringing restaurants to town or retail. Nice shops, and maybe on the upper floors you have apartments or condos or whatever. I think that's a wonderful idea. I think we need to be cautious about where it is. So we need to study that. We need to understand where we would put these mixed-use districts. I think that we need to be cautious of traffic and of parking. Parking is always a challenge in Billerica, so we need to be conscientious of that. We're very fortunate to have a town manager who, along with others, has successfully done this in other communities. In fact, he was in Woburn when they went to some of the mixed-use districts. So I certainly would encourage us. I think it's a great time. I think town meeting has changed a lot in the last 2-3 years. I think we see a lot of new members, and I think it would go through if we put it through again.
Thank you, Mr. Similaris.
Thank you.
So the question about mixed use is that, first of all, I already mentioned that we pay $33 and change, or businesses, we charge $33 and change per tax for business, commercial space, restaurants, industry, whatever. We pay $14 as residential. So they want to take our center and make it a mixed use. So where are we going to have all these big restaurants and entertainment centers? We have Mondra Mondra, we have Liberty Bell, we have our nice strip right there right now, which I think is lovely in the center there. So what are we going to do? Put a couple floors on top and maybe have some... I don't know what we would think of. Maybe buy the Masonic building off the Masons and turn that into some kind of entertainment / convenience store. You know what? I like our center the way it is. We have plenty of areas to build, have other areas build commercial base, and I don't know what the deal is. Also, what I'm worried about is that because we owe $500 million in debt liability, we don't owe it. But we have $290 million in unfunded liabilities. Then we have $200 million. We have $100 million for the new high school. Another $100 million in long-term debt. That's close to $500 million in debt liabilities. And our budgets—we're not swimming in money. I'll make that clear.
So we're talking
mixed use in the center, and I don't want to get rid of real estate for residential there and turn it into a strip mall of little convenience. We're already losing the Red Barn. They're knocking the Red Barn down and the house. They're going to put a drugstore there. So that's not in a historical district. Don't think the historical things are covered just because they're old. So I'm skeptical of the mixed use, to be very frank with you, even though we need money. We need money because we're going deeper in debt with unfunded liability. Thank you.
Okay, John. Mr. Giroux.
Thank you. So mixed use is a zoning overlay district, so it would actually change the zoning. Any changes to the buildings wouldn't be borne, the cost of that would not be borne by the town. It would actually be borne by whoever owns the property and decided to take advantage of the mixed use zoning that would be in place. I think the time is ready. I think it didn't pass prior in prior attempts simply because there was no project to see. Quite frankly, when you put an idea forward, people want to see what it looks like. They want to see what it is they're voting on. And as a concept, it's a little difficult to do that. So I'm hoping, as Mrs. Conway said, that if we put it forward again, we could have some examples of what it might look like. I'll point to, I'm not familiar with Woodward, I'll point to Lexington Center, I'll point to the recent redesign of Bedford Center, remodeling that's been going on there. Those are very attractive buildings. They're mixed use. There's apartments or condos on the top floors and retail / restaurants at the bottom floors. I think it could work in Billerica. Where it would be, the center is a prime location, I think. But again, keep in mind, this isn't going to cost the town necessarily. In fact, it might increase the revenue for the town in terms of taxes received once the development actually happens. But we have to get it passed first, and I think part of it is to conceptualize what it might look like, and that will help people vote for it.
Mr. Rosen.
Thank you. I'm not against mixed use. In fact, we already have it in town. If you look at, we have a mixed use overlay for the Mill District, which the mill is over by the Faulkner Mill. There's mixed use over there. There's residences, businesses, and that's already in place there. Mixed use in the center, when it's come before town meeting, I have opposed it. And one of the things I said at town meeting is if you draw a 1 mile circle around the center of our town, we have 1,800 garden style type apartments that would be the same as mixed use over the businesses that we have. Now, if you're concerned about the traffic in the center of town now, can you picture a second floor being put on the Billerica Mall, having that be all apartments? We do have some mixed use in the center. If you look at the white buildings where Manny's store is, there's apartments above some of those. Those are pre-existing non-conforming mixed use. Mr. Giroux is correct that it would be an overlay. I am open to it. I supported it when it was over in the Mill District. It made sense over there. And if it makes sense, then it's worth doing. But what happened at town meeting is they wanted to come forward with putting this overlay on 56 parcels, some of which included the mall. And that at that point in time, with no plan, the traffic being what it was, there was no reason for us to go forward. We don't need any more apartments in the center of our town. I think there's other sections of town where that may be applicable, but certainly not in the center.
Just as a follow-up question, though, real quickly. Mixed use only in the center, or are there other neighborhoods, for example? And I'm sorry, Mr. Rosen. Is there another neighborhood in town or another section of Boston Road that mixed use?
Well, I mean, you could, a mixed use is an overlay. So what would happen is town meeting would adopt a mixed use overlay. And then project by project, parcel by parcel, somebody would come before town meeting and say, I want to apply that overlay to that parcel. Just like we created the mixed-use overlay for the Mill District, and it was applied to the Mill Building over in the Faulkner Mills. So it could be applied anywhere, but to do it arbitrarily the way they wanted to do a town meeting with like 50-some-odd parcels, blindly, without any plan, is irresponsible. If we create the overlay and then have a project come before town meeting and give town meeting the opportunity, parcel by parcel, to look at the project and decide whether or not they want it there, that's significantly different.
Mrs. Conley.
Thank you. So the original proposals that we've heard in the last few years have been around the center. I think the center would be a good opportunity. I absolutely agree. We're all in agreement, I think all of us, that the center traffic would need to be redesigned and the parking. I think that's a good place to start. I think each parcel needs to be, each proposal needs to be reviewed on its own merit. So if the center is the place to start, which I happen to think it is the optimal place to start, but it certainly could go in other areas within the town, and we'd review it like we do with everything on a case-by-case basis.
Similarities.
Well, we come back to the center again, that little piece of land that keeps popping up all the time. But, you know, again, I think that if we, you know, developed our center to turn it, like, maybe to look like Woburn, to have maybe two or three floors on the buildings that are there now, and, you know, I know where people are going to park anyway, but like I said, maybe we could sell the Masonic building and do something over there, and, you know, there's not much space there. I love our center right now. Whatever we gained in money and from tax would be lost with aesthetic value. And I think, I mean, if we went to the mall and they wanted to maybe go do something at the mall, I don't know what they would want to have apartments above the mall. It doesn't make sense. So I'm adamantly against changing our center around our roadways, our buildings, and you know, I don't want to turn Billerica into Woburn. Mr. Curran's from Woburn. He's our manager. I like him. I work well with him, I think he's doing a good job. But this isn't Woburn, and I don't ever want to see it look like Woburn. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Drew. You had the last word.
I'm sorry, well, could you repeat the question? It's been a while.
There was a follow-up to the mixed use. You know, is mixed use, should that be only for the center, or are there other areas of town maybe along Boston Road that you think would qualify?
No, I think there are others. I mean, we talked about the center because that's where it was proposed prior to this. And other towns have had it succeed in the center, as I mentioned, Lexington and Bedford specifically. But I think it could be used anywhere else is commercial retail space available.
Okay, and we'll move on. Next question. We'll start with you, Mr. Similaris. There was a discussion in an earlier forum about meals tax. This will be a short answer. And if the town were to approve a meals tax, would you prefer the money to go to the general fund or a site-specific purpose? Because you can do either under the law.
Right. Well, we have unfunded liabilities that grew by $15 million this year, and they're going to grow by that next year. And they're going to keep growing, and somebody's going to end up having to pay these. It's going to be coming out of the budget. So we're looking at ways. I think we should be somehow putting $3 million a year into the unfunded liabilities. It's for health insurance that we haven't paid for in the past. We haven't put any money away. And, you know, it's a myriad of problems with this, but it's growing, and we're going to end up having to pay it. So if we implement the meals tax, it probably could raise about $500,000, $500,000 a year, which is, you know, not enough to cover any of the unfunded liabilities. It would help, surely. However, if we put a tax on, I voted against the meals tax, because I was thinking that we already pay enough taxes, and I really, most of our residents would be the ones, as Mr. Drew expressed in the last debate that we had, of a $50 meal, I think it would be, I think he said 37 cents or something like that, so it's minimal. However, if we did implement this tax to get
to our revenue stream, if we don't put that into our revenue stream, we don't have to raise your taxes, because that money has to come from somewhere. It's not money that we don't need, it is money we do need. So, frankly, it's great that the selectmen are talking about using it, but it's the wrong thing, because it's going to increase all your taxes. So I would urge you, that's misconstrued when they say new growth. New growth is utilized every single year to keep our taxes low. In fact, up until John Curran joined us, this town taxed the maximum legally allowed. Every year we maxed to the tax. It's called the levy. So every year we taxed to the maximum levy that we could. John Curran joined us. In the 4 or 5 years he's been here, every year we backed off and backed off, and it's because of ideas like this, like using new growth. So I would absolutely not want to use new growth for OPEB. Again, to go back to your original question, Tom,
so
I would absolutely in favor of the meals tax.
Actually, Mr. Rosen, you were mentioning, if we can do it in 1 minute, it would be great.
I don't know if I can do it in 1 minute, but I'll try.
Thank you.
For starters, Billerica has always had a good bond rating. It's true that it's gone to a AA+ while Mr. Curran was there. And the comment that, you know, while I was chairman, we tried to fire him, that's not true. What happened is we had an executive session. There were issues brought up with concerns about Mr. Curran. And Mr. Curran is a direct report to the Board of Selectmen. You know, like in any managerial hierarchy, you need to deal with things appropriately. We had an executive session. We met in that executive session. And I think everyone, including Mr. Curran, and the relationship with the board is better for it. I think you see that at the selectmen's meetings. We were working very well together. We ironed out some problems, and we moved forward. We said right from the onset, the goal was not to fire Mr. Curran, it was to solve problems. So that was factually false. And the other thing is, it's good that Mrs. Conway is weighing in on the OPEB discussion now, because, quite frankly, if she's on the Board of Selectmen, due to her husband and her brother-in-law working for the town, she won't be able to participate in this discussion. This is the single biggest debt that the town of Billerica has, and she won't be able to participate in the discussion. So, you know, when you want to talk about ideas and all that, we can do it here, but she won't be able to do it there. And putting out new growth, that's one of many suggestions. As I said, we've asked the town manager to do multiple analysis for us. We're not going into this blind. We're going to make educated decisions, and we're going to make the right decisions to Billerica, and we're going to move forward cautiously.
Here's what I'd like to do. Is
excuse
time
me.
Growing short?
He called
Ms.
me out. Oh, come on.
Right. If I can explain, please. Mrs. Conway, you were mentioned. I'd like to give you 1 minute to respond. If you do so without mentioning anybody else, that would be great, because I would like to give Mr. Similaris and Mr. Drew 1 minute as well to dive in on any of this discussion, and then we go to closing statements.
Sure.
So if you could, please. Thank you.
I absolutely can do it, not mention anybody else. So Mr. Roser called out, I'm just keep identifying me, that he felt it necessary to point out that my husband is a lieutenant of the police department, my father, my brother-in-law is the fire chief. I'm certainly never going to apologize to them. I am proud of the careers they've both chosen, and they've made numerous sacrifices for this town. Certain people would like to take credit for this being the 61st safest town in the country. I think it's because of people like the firefighters, the police, the DPW. So I know there's a lot of people that like to take credit for it. But let me just say, very quickly, I went to the Board of State of Ethics in the Ethics Commission, I apologize, in January. I told them I was running. I asked them for their advice. What can I and can I not participate in? They gave me a very nice ruling. It's kind of a how-to. I know exactly what I can participate in and exactly what I can't. I didn't wait for something to occur and then go to ethics. I went proactively. Essentially, 2% of the time, I will have to recuse myself. I'm not misleading any of you. This is a fact. This happens often in towns in Massachusetts. In fact, it happens so often that they have a specific section on this in the ethics. So absolutely, and I talked about this, I couldn't be any more transparent on this. I've talked about the previous debate, which Mr. Rosa wasn't at. I talked about, I did a press release, which Mr. Zupa knows, on March 3rd, releasing exactly what the Ethics Commission did. So I don't know what else to do. I think that having me not participate 2% and be able to participate in more than 98% would be extremely valuable to this town.
I'm going to give Mr. Similaris and Mr. Drew Woodman, if they would like.
I would like it.
And then we need to go to final answers. Well, so we're going to kick us out.
Since there's only a minute for me to speak, I'll make it as clear as I can. First of all, the question was about new growth.
Somewhere in
there. Yeah, the 900, I believe that it's 900,000 that we incurred in new growth this year. Talking about new growth, and we were talking about the OPEB liabilities. So even if you put the whole $900,000 towards OPEB, and you put the $500,000 toward a meals tax, that only brings you up to $1.4 million, which we really have. Arlington, for example, has $7 million in their OPEB account. It's about the same size town as our town. But anyway, getting back to what I was trying to say, and well, that was about that, but about that we're going to be bailed out by the state. That is not true. I talked to the governor when he was here. I talked to many officials. The state is trillions of dollars in debt. How are they going to be able to pay all cities and towns for their debt that we have? We have to start reining in the debt somehow, figuring it out, what we're going to do, and paying it. And if we have to bite the bullet to pay the retirement that we promised, then we got to do it.
Okay, so that's your minute. And Mr. Giroux, 59 seconds.
Thank you. Maybe I'll use 45. So a couple different things. The new growth, someone said it earlier, I think the new growth is budgeted for. This revenue that we know we're going to get, are we counting on, and it's already used in the budget. So to direct that toward OPEB is not going to work, because we're going to have to raise taxes someplace else. What I will say as far as the town manager and the executive session regarding him almost a year ago, I've served on 3 different town manager screening committees over the last 10 years. That means we've needed, on average, about 4 times. We have gone through 4 town managers since I've been involved with the town. That's only about 12 or 15 years. And there's one common denominator, so I'll leave it at that.
Okay, we're going to move to closing statements. And Mr. Rosa, I will let you go first. We have 2 minutes, candidates, closing statements. Please look into the camera. Make your best pitch for a vote on April 2nd. And please don't mention anybody else.
Thank you to the Lowell Sun for organizing this debate and the Senior Center for sponsoring it. I'd also like to wish my dad a happy birthday. Thank you. When I first ran for the Board of Selectmen, I was excited and full of energy to make Billerica better for all of us. I encourage you to look at my accomplishments and successes with helping our seniors and work I have done with our veterans groups, helping individuals as well as families throughout the town. This motivates me as much today as it did in day one. I enjoy the challenge of being presented with a problem and finding solutions. That makes someone's life even better. Even if it's as simple as a senior citizen parking space at Town Hall or a mailbox at residents can drop off mail 24/7, to bigger challenges like bringing in a townwide recycling project, townwide recycling that saves millions of dollars in taxpayer dollars. How can you not be excited about a town when in the year the Board of Selectmen has reduced taxes, we've scheduled over $20 million in infrastructure work, like maintaining our roads, building maintenance projects on our town hall, our senior center, and our library. We're also working on a bike path and a boat launch so you can enjoy the natural resources Billerica has to offer. We have hired a full-time economic development director to continue filling our vacant commercial space. This allows us to lower taxes and stabilize tax rates. We created a funding plan for our new high school with the town contributing $21.5 million towards the debt exclusion to minimize the tax impacts to the residents. We created an expedited sewer plan that eliminates 10 years off the previous plan, getting the town 95% sewered in 9 years, with the remaining 5% to follow. This is a snapshot of what good, sound financial management, good planning, and leadership can do for you. Billerica is a great town to live, work, and raise a family, and it's been an honor to serve the residents of Billerica. If you believe, as I do, that we want to continue to excel and improve every day, then I respectfully ask you for one of your votes on Saturday, April 2nd, to re-elect me, Michael Rosa, to the Board of Selectmen, and this is how we will keep Billerica moving forward. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rosa. Mrs. Conway, 2 minutes, please.
Thank you. So I'd like to thank the Lowell Sun, Tom Zupa, Council on Aging. Most importantly, I'd like to thank the residents. There's a full room here for you. For those of you at home, you can't see that. It's great to see a local election that we have a full room for a debate. It really is. I'd also like to thank all the residents at home that are watching, and Rick Sobey, who's tweeting away, I imagine. So thank you all very much. After listening to the debate, reading the news, and researching the candidates, I hope you agree with me that it's surely time for a change on our Board of Selectmen. Tonight, you've heard a common theme. The incumbents are resistant to change. They've lost touch. They don't necessarily listen to the experts because they are the experts. My background, business acumen, coupled with municipal experience on my 10 years on the school committee, will make me a great selectman for town. I will bring a fresh, new perspective to the Board of Selectmen. I will represent each and every citizen and not certain groups. I will listen to the experts, just like I do in my job every day. I will weigh their inputs. I will make informed, unbiased decisions. I will represent you. My name is Kim Conway. I respectfully ask for one of your two votes for selectmen on Saturday, April 2nd. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Conway. Mr. Similaris, 2 minutes, please.
Thank you. I'm honored to be a selectman in Billerica. I take this duty very seriously. I think I'm accessible. I'm energetic. I'm informed. And I try to always better myself by going out and seeing what bothers the residents, what problems and concerns they have. I think that I have helped this board of selectmen in the last 3 years, whether I agree with the other selectmen and they agree with me or the manager. I must say, for the record, I never contemplated firing the manager. We did have a meeting with him, and I don't know if anybody else had that in their mind, but it didn't come up to fire him, and he's still here. And I think that I like him. I work well with him. I don't agree with a lot of his things that he's, not a lot, there's a few things, but I think he's a good guy. And the rest of the Board of Selectmen, I think that we've done a good job, and I'm honored to work with him. And I have, there's plenty more work to do. I don't mean to blow my own horn, but I do. And the point is that I have brought issues to the public that they might not have had an opportunity to know. The prison, for example, I started a petition that we're going to come in here with a $37 million temporary addition to our prison. Why don't we have sidewalks on Boston Road? Every other neighboring town has them. It's a state road. We need sidewalks on, we need to get our state legislators working to get sidewalks on Boston Road. We don't have the money for it. We have some debt. We have a great town, and I just think it's a good town, and I think the one thing I do try to do, if I have another 20 seconds, is that I try to be inclusive with people coming to join government. You know, we have smart people, whether or not you agree with them, they care about Billerica, and I think they should have, we should listen to them and hear their ideas. They could help us, and we are like a sports team. We're, you know, not everybody's on the same level. No one's on the same financial level or ability level, but we have to move ahead as a town. We have to be concerned about the people that have different financial statuses and different situations, and that's what I think I do very well at. Thank you.
Thank you. And finally, Mr. Drury, 2 minutes, please.
Thank you. I'd like to first thank our host, the Lowell Sun, the Council on Aging, and I'm not going to forget Tom this time.
Thank you.
Tom Zupa for moderating. Also to Rick Sobey and the room full of people here. I'm glad that there's a lot of people here actually watching the debate. Local government is where the action is. This is where you get the most bang for your buck. My wife and I grew up in Billerica and attended Billerica Public Schools. I earned a bachelor's degree from UMass Lowell and an MBA just 2 years ago. So I understand and appreciate the rich history here. I also recognize the times have changed, and the town, the way it operates, needs to change with it. I believe that I'm the right person to help the work and move forward in a positive direction. I'll be this town's biggest cheerleader on the Board of Selectmen. I've served on several different committees over the years, including town meeting, and I've chaired the Finance Committee for 4 years. That, to me, is extremely important simply because people have thought enough of me to vote me chairman for 4 years. That means I'm fair, I'm honest, and I'm direct. I've served on the Scholarship Foundation Committee, as I mentioned a little while ago, 3 different town manager screening committees, among some others. My reasons for running for a seat on the Board of Selectmen are simple. I'm running to ensure that the town continues to progress and improve. I'll bring a unique blend of business and analytical skills to the board. I'll respect the process and, using my skills as an auditor, analyze the data before me in order to make an informed decision. I want to give back to the town that's given my family and I so much. I believe Billerica must get past the obstacles to embrace its future. And on April 2nd, get past the obstacles and vote for Ed Giroux. I'm fourth on the ballot on April 2nd. Polls are open from 8 to 8. Thank you.
Candidates, thank you very much. Give a round of applause, please. Thank you. We need to do some wrap-up here, which is this debate, if you missed any part of it, will be available on lowellsun.com and our YouTube channel tonight or tomorrow morning, so you can watch it in its entirety again, if you wish. Thank you to the Senior Center for opening up this great site for us, and also opening the doors and providing a fan. I got a little cooler later on. We actually have the overflow seating as well tonight. We have a big crowd, so thank all of you for being here and being invested in town government. Once again, thank you very much. April 2nd town election polls open 8 to 8. You can vote absentee till noon on April 1st. Mr. Similaris, Mr. Giroux, Mr. Rose, and Mrs. Conley, thank you once again. Best of luck to all of you on April 2nd.
Thank you
very much.